Hi everyone, so it's 4:45, we can start the lecture. So today we'll continue with loops and methods. And I just want to point you to the fact that I posted a sample exam in assignments between homework one and homework two. There is a sample exam. Take this test with the logon browser. Like the real exam, you have 80 minutes to complete the exam. This is just a test. You are not going to It's a sample. We are not going to grade it in any way, but I would advise you to try to take it the same way that you would take the real exam. It's a closed book exam, the real exam. You're not allowed to use the textbooks, lecture notes, cheat sheets, or anything else during the exam. Use well-named variables and include any documentation that you feel that is necessary to understand your algorithms. You can use three white sheets of scrap paper. Just show them at the beginning of the exam when you show your environment around you. They will be useful for calculations of number system conversions, like binary to decimal, decimal to binary. Being a closed book exam, no calculators are allowed for number conversions. You must just do them yourself using the division by two or multiplication with powers of two to actually do the conversions yourself. I also posted a little bit more details about the logistics of the midterm. So the midterm will be exactly 1 week from today. It will become available on Blackboard, the bottom of the page at the time of the exam, 4:45 next Tuesday. You must use the logon browser to take the exam. I will be available on my office hours Google Meet in case that you encounter problems. Just join it and I will basically direct you what to do. Other than that, basically just take the exam with the logon browser. We will grade the exam the day of the exam itself in the during the night, and we will announce the results on Piazza. Following the grading, you can see your exam on logon browser by clicking on the exam attempt. And then you can see your answers, the correct answers, and any notes, feedback that was given by us. The midterm will be based on the lectures that we cover up to Thursday. Like the sample exam that you will see that I uploaded on Blackboard, and is also here, you will see that it has multi-choice questions, fill in the blank, analyze some code. I'm giving you a piece of code and I'm asking you what's the output of this program. Before you take the exam, make sure that you downloaded the Responders logon browser. This is the software. It's like a Mozilla Firefox or Chrome or Edge or Safari. It's a browser, but it only opens a single tab. You open on that tab the Blackboard, go to assignments for our class, click on the exam. It will basically let you to get in. Now, the way that I set up the exam is that you see all of the questions at once. And in case that you lose connectivity, you can just get back and continue the same exam. You have the rest of the time, 80 minutes since the beginning of the exam. Take this test with the logon browser again. It's a closed book exam. You can use three white sheets of scrap paper. Just show them at the beginning of the exam. And other than that, just take the exam. Okay. Okay. So now we'll continue with the lecture, the rest of the lecture.
Professor?
Yes.
Sorry, I just joined. Can you confirm, is the exam next Thursday for us?
It's next Tuesday.
Okay, next Tuesday.
Yes, 3-9. We follow the original syllabus. We did lose one lecture at the beginning, which basically means that we are one lecture behind. So we'll not cover multidimensional arrays in time for the exam. But I believe that we will actually cover up to and including arrays. Today, the goal is to finish with loops and do methods.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, So last time we talked about while loops. So while loops are, they have the same syntax with if statements, only the keyword is while instead of if. And their semantics is that you iterate through the while loop while the condition is true. Another type of loop available in Java are do while loops. So do while loops have the condition at the end of the loop body. So basically you will execute at least once the loop body before testing the condition. They are very good for printing menus. Most of you, if not everybody, made a call to an automatic center and you are told press one for some representative, press two, and so on. This is similar to what a do while loop. It gives you the options and you can choose at least one option before you are checking for the condition, if the option was to exit or to repeat that operation. So if you look at the flowchart, you start by executing the loop body of the do while statement and then check the condition. So if the condition is true, you return back to the beginning and you re-execute the loop body, then check the condition again until the condition becomes false. The moment that the condition becomes false, you exit. So let's see basically what are they useful for. They are useful for things that execute at least once, like a program menu, like this one. So here we have a scanner that asks the user to enter a selection. So we define the variables and the scanner object outside the loop. And then we start printing the menu inside the do while loop. So we print out that if the user chooses P, we print the counter. And if they chooses Q, we quit, we exit the do while loop. Other than that, we print out that the user must enter an option and we read that string that is the selection. If the selection in uppercase is equal with uppercase P, so basically either that the user entered lowercase or uppercase, to uppercase will become uppercase P. If it's equal with uppercase P, then we print out the counter and we increment the counter with one. So initially the counter was zero. So if the user enters P, then it will print counter is zero and then increments counter to one. Now, this loop will exit when the condition becomes false. So the condition in this case is that it's not true that the selection in uppercase is equal with uppercase Q. So as long as the user doesn't enter Q, this will repeat. So if the user enters A or B, there is nothing that is done except printing up the menu again and asking for the option, the user will enter an option. When the user enters Q, either in lowercase or uppercase, the selection to uppercase becomes uppercase Q, equal with Q is true, and the negation of true is false, and we exit the do while statement. So let me show you an example session. So we start the program and the program prints out, choose a menu option, print the counter and or quit. And we enter P. So what happens in this program? Because we entered P, the selection in uppercase is P, the counter is zero, the old counter. We increment the counter with one. Since P is not equal with Q, that's false. And not false is true, which means that repeat. So as long as the condition is still true, we continue re-executing and we print out again the menu. Choose a menu option, print or quit. Let's say that the user enters A. A has, it's not P, it's not Q. So it just returns back to in the do while loop and prints the menu again. Print the counter, quit. Let's say that the user enters P again, we print out the counter, which is now one. Then since it's not Q, it continues the do while loop. So prints up the menu again. And finally the user enters Q and we exit the do while loop. So it's really like one of those phone systems that asks you all the time, do this, see your balance or pay your balance or talk with a representative. And you choose an option and then it gives you another menu and another menu until you basically quit. I wouldn't say that it is like a switch command, but the fact that we had that to uppercase that we also use for a switch command, that's more or less true. It's a loop. Yes, that's true. That is true. In the first case is like a switch command. That's right. Good. Now,
in this example, shouldn't, when you say while in the selection to uppercase equals Q, then shouldn't the loop run while it's equal to Q?
So if it's equal with Q, then so
this, oh, there's a not.
It's a not here.
Okay.
Exactly. So this, it runs in a loop while it's true. But when is it true? When actually the selection is not equal with Q.
Oh, okay.
Selection with Q, it's false. And it, so you are right, that not is the reason why this loop while is not a Q.
Yeah, I see. Thank you.
Welcome. So the counter is 2. So this is a post increment. Mukamel is asking why the counter was 0 at the beginning, because we print the counter and the old value of the counter, which was 0, then the counter is incremented with 1. It's only incremented when the user enters P. So in the example here, the user entered P once, we printed the old counter, we incremented to 1 the counter. Next time we entered A, which is not inside the if statement, so the counter is not incremented. Next, we enter P, which prints the old counter again, because this is a post increment. So it's the old value of the counter, which was 1 after we incremented once with 1. But you are right, when we exit, because this is a post increment, the counter would be 2. So if I would print in the statement where I say goodbye, the value of the counter, it will print 2. The third kind of loops are the most common kind of loops in Java, for loops. So a for loop has a new syntax that you haven't seen before. For, open parenthesis, initial action, semicolon, loop continuation condition, semicolon, action after each iteration, close parenthesis, and then you have a block or a single statement. So how does this execute? Basically, first, the initial action is executed only once. Then the loop continuation condition is evaluated. If it's true, it executes the loop body and it executes the action after each iteration. So if the condition was true, it executes the body, then the action after each iteration, then it returns back and tries again the loop continuation condition until the loop continuation condition becomes false. If it was false from the beginning, then the blue body would never have been executed. You would just continue with the next statement after the for loop. So let me show you an example. So here we have integer I is defined before the for loop. For starting with I equal with 0, as long as I is less than 100, print out welcome to Java and execute I plus plus after each iteration. So how is this compiled internally? I is assigned with 0 is right at the beginning before we actually have that loop. Then we check the condition, 0 less than 100 is true. So now we print out welcome to Java. Then we execute I plus plus, the action after each iteration. So I is incremented to 1. And then we check again the condition. So now again, is 1 less than 100? Yes, print out welcome to Java. Increment I to 2, then is 2 less than 100, yes. And this basically goes in this loop until I becomes 100 after we increment I. 100 less than 100 is false, and it exits the for loop. These are the most common kind of loops. They are used for counting mostly. When you know exactly how many steps you want to execute, like you want to iterate through the characters of a string, or you want to basically iterate with numbers, let's say from 1 to 100, and do an operation like print out a statement or compute the sum of the numbers from 1 to 100 and so on. So they are very popular for counting through the indices of a string, through the indices of an array. I will show you later this week what an array is and how to iterate through the indices, through some algorithm. Let's say that you want to implement an algorithm that prints a string, the characters in a string in reverse order. It's good for algorithms that require some known number of iterations. You know exactly that we iterate the number of the characters in the string or the number of numbers between one and n. It's very good for what are called counter controlled loops. So let me show you an example. The first one is through the indices of a string, okay? So I'm going to go to Eclipse and let's assume that I'm reading a string. So we need a scanner. This is a new scanner for the system input stream. And I define a string, let's call it S. It's input.next line. So let's also print the user enter something. System. Print. Enter a string. So now let's, what I want, let's say, is the characters in that string one per line. So that's a for loop, starts with an integer equal with zero, the first character of the first index of the string, as long as I is less than the length of the string, strictly less than the length of the string. I is incremented with one after each iteration, and we print the character at index I in that string, okay? And let's actually print them one per line. That's the entire program. It's a for loop that iterates from zero to the length of the string, the index of the first character to the last one, which is the index prior to the length of the string. So it's the length of the string minus one. For every character, it prints out on one line that character. So if we run it, let's, it's a Java application. We want to enter a string. So let's enter poll and it prints one character per line, P, A, U, L. So it's a for loop. It has an initial action, a condition, and an action after each iteration. Now, one other thing that I said here is good for algorithms that requires a number of iterations. So let's modify our requirement. Instead of printing the characters in ascending order, let's print them from the end to the beginning. So end to beginning. So how would we implement that algorithm? So now we can actually start with the length of the string. Minus one, the index of the last character. As long as I is greater than equal with zero, the I is an index in the string. And instead of incrementing with one at every step, decrement with one at every step. So basically it starts from the end and we print the characters of the string from the end one by one. Again, we decrement at every step and we check that we didn't reach minus one, which is not an index. So we run again, and now let's say that we enter also poll, and we get by this algorithm L, U, A, and uppercase P. So you can basically see that we implemented the algorithm, what was required, print the characters one per line from the end to the beginning. So for loops are very useful for basically writing a counting from either that you want to count from n back to one, or you want to count from one to n. All of these kind of operations can be implemented with for loops.
Professor, quick question.
Go ahead.
In the code before this, where it said that that one is less than s.
This one?
Yeah, this one, yeah. But isn't the length of s just like Oh, okay.
Length
okay.
of the string.
The input. Okay.
Understood. It's the string that we enter, the length of the string.
Okay. Understood. Thank you.
Welcome. Okay. So here is that example that appeared here, but not up to 100, but up to 2. So before the loop begins, we define the integer I. It's just a location memory. We execute the action before the first iteration, basically the initial action, I is assigned 0. We do the loop continuation condition, is 0 less than 2? Yes. We print out welcome to Java once. Then we increment I with 1. So I is now 1 because it was 0 before. 1 less than 2 is still true. We print out again welcome to Java the second time. Then we increment I from 1 to 2. 2 less than 2 is false, and we exit the for loop. So really, the hard way is to understand how these three parts of the for loop are executed. It's basically that the initial action is executed only once at the beginning, then the loop continuation condition is executed, then the loop body, then the action after each iteration, then the condition again, and we go in a loop. Now, the for initial action can actually be empty. So it can be between 0 and more comma separated expressions. It can have multiple parts or none whatsoever. So like here, I can show you this second example, integer I equals 0, j equals 0. So there are two things that are assigned 0 when we actually define, when we start the loop, the for loop. The action after each iteration can be any statement. In our example, we had just I++, but you can modify that and just put a print statement, a system out print statement. In fact, even in my example, instead of just incrementing I here, I could take this system out println and put it here. Of course, we shouldn't forget to post increment I at every step. And this will be doing exactly the same thing that the previous code did. So we enter poll and it prints the letters because this action after each iteration can be any statement, can be actually multiple statements separated by commas. Now, what is the body of this for statement is the no op statement, is the no operation statement, semicolon by itself. Again, remember that semicolon is just like a statement. This loop in the body doesn't have anything, but it has the printout and the increment in the loop action after each iteration. Now, of course, this is pretty ugly, so don't ever write code like this, but it is possible. So this is totally possible to have a statement or multiple statements. Like in this example, I increment both I and J as the action after each iteration. So basically, both the initial action and the action after each iteration can be one or multiple statements separated by commas, because we use semicolon to separate the three parts of the for loop. Okay. Any questions? Now, if you leave them completely empty, like the loop continuation condition is empty whatsoever, then it's implicitly true. It's equivalent with having a while loop that has as the continuation condition true. So for can actually be left completely empty. If this condition is empty, the middle operator in that operand in that for is empty, it's assumed to be implicitly true. It's like writing an infinite loop. Now, these are useful when you have a server. So when you have a server and you want to run in a loop forever, and let's say that you're waiting for clients to connect and you spawn a thread that will actually reply to that client or actually just reply to the client in the while loop. You would have an infinite loop like this one, while true, do something. But this is quite seldom. Like it's basically when you write servers, no other time you would use an infinite loop. either that is written with a for loop or with a while loop. Caution about the semicolon after the for statement. Like in the previous example here, where we put semicolon, so this for loop is executed and there is no body, or the body is basically no operation. Be very careful if you have a block and you have a printout statement that is in that block. However, the for loop actually ends already. So you see the problem here is that you have a for loop that iterates from 0 to 10, increments I with 1, but then you have a semicolon, meaning that the loop body is just nothing. So the problem here is that you actually have a syntax error, because this integer I is defined only internally to the for loop. It's basically a local variable to the for loop. So when you want to print it outside the for loop, because you put this semicolon here and this for loop ends here, this I is unknown. This is a common mistake when you use this beginning of line block, beginning of block style, which we don't use much these days. It was quite used when people were programming in C, but these days usually you use the end of line style for beginning of block. This is even worse. So before, at least we had a syntax error. So before, we basically, the syntax error was that I is unknown because it was a local variable in the for loop. But now we have a while statement, while integer I is 0, while I is less than 10, semicolon. And then you have other statements like printing out the value of I and I++. What do you think that is printed in this case, in this program? Anyone? So Shri Charan says 0. No, because this is an infinite loop. I is 0 forever. 0 less than 10, it's true forever. You are basically, I is never increment exactly. So I is never incremented at all. Basically, while is 0 less than 10? Yes, do nothing. Is 0 less than 10? Yes, do nothing. So this actually will never ever get to the second two statements. If this would have been passed, then you would have been right, this would have been 0. But it will never pass this statement because it's an infinite loop. So it's like while true, nothing. So it's basically an infinite loop. That's why it is not a compiler error. So unless you realize what's happening, you are just waiting without knowing why is it hanging. It's not hanging, it's running that loop forever. Oh, why is the while true always? Because 0 less than 10 is true. And it will never continue with the next statement. See, this semicolon is actually the body of the while loop. Okay. Unless you still have a question. So this, what I'm basically showing here is if you have integer I is equal to 0, and then you have a while I is less than 10, semicolon. That semicolon, the white spaces mean nothing in Java. If you have the while loop, the semicolon here or here, it's exactly the same, it's pretty much the same. So now if you have a system.out.print the value of I, nothing will be printed. But worse than that, if you look here, the program is still running forever. So you have actually to kill it, terminate it, because you are actually not going to print ever anything, okay? So, and actually I can show you that if I remove this semicolon and I print the value of I, and only later I print out goodbye, goodbye will never be printed. It just prints 0 forever. So print 0 forever and basically. I have to kill it, otherwise it will not be able to, I will not be able to see it. Okay.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Why can't you see the zero that's being printed?
I think I, because I didn't use println, it actually printed one long line and then it ran out of basically space in that one line. So okay. I believe that if I take out this println and I kill it, I still don't see the zero. But it's basically because it's so fast. If you look at it, you actually see a long zero for a second and then it disappears.
Oh, but the zeros are still printing?
They are printing forever.
Okay, I see. Thank you.
While false will exit immediately, so it will never print anything. It's basically, is it ever false? No. So this statement is never ever reached. In fact, if you try something like this, it will tell you. So let's say instead of false is 1 > 2, and we know that that's false. Remove including condition. Ah. It basically even realizes that this is never going to be true. So something that is false, is it true that I is greater than?
So would it just print out goodbye then?
Yeah. Okay. Exactly. Yep. Okay. Now, do while loops and for loops are, they can represent the same complexity. So in programming, when we mean expressivity for a programming language, we really mean what kind of complexity classes can be represented by those constructs, like in this case, the different kind of loops. So this is not quite 100%. So there is one question, what's the difference between print and println? println prints a new line after the output that is printed. Print only prints the output and the cursor stays wherever you basically left it. Okay. So you can see here. So let's assume that we do here a loop and here we increment I at every step. So now if we run this, it will print less than 10. It will print from 0 to 10, one per line and then goodbye. If we use print instead of println, it will print from 0 to 10 and then 0 to 9 and then goodbye. So print does not include new line. println includes new line. Okay. So I was saying that they can represent problems in the same complexity classes. In fact, you can write equivalent loops between while loops to for loops or vice versa from for loops to while loops, basically a for loop. A while loop can be written as a for loop where the initial condition is empty and the action after each iteration is empty. So you see it's a one-to-one correspondence, equivalent statements. If you have a for loop, the initial action can be put before the while statement. Then we have a while statement with the loop continuation condition, the same loop body, and then the action after each iteration is put after the loop body. So every for loop can be written as a while loop. And every while loop can be written into a for loop and vice versa. You can actually write do while loops into while loops and for loops and for loops into and while loops into do while loops. So they are expressively equivalent, but this doesn't include the ease of use. So it's always, there are problems that map to a better loop construct. So if you have a counting loop, you will definitely use a for statement because you know you want to count from, let's say, 1 to n or 0 to n. If you have a manual kind of system where you want at least once to be executed, you would use a do while statement. If you have some kind of case in which you want to test a condition after each iteration, like for instance, I want to sum all the numbers from 1 to 20 and stop when I reach 100. That for that kind of program, a while loop is better, because you don't know how after how many, after 14, you will actually have 105 as the sum. So basically, each one of these loops maps to a better, to a different kind of problem that you try to solve. So let's start with a couple of examples. For instance, you want to compute the sum for some iteration from 0 to from 1 to let's say 4. You would use a in for loop that iterates from j equal 1 to j less than equal with 4, increment j after each iteration, and the sum is incremented with j. However, be very careful not to double increment your variable. This is again a very common mistake at the beginning, that you have a for loop which already has j incremented with 1, but you also put that as j plus plus as at the end of the for loop. Usually this happens when you do transform from a while loop to a for loop, that you actually duplicate the addition. So be careful not to double update your counting variable. A flag can also be used as a loop control. Sometimes the loop condition is too complicated to include it at once into the while statement. So internally, you would basically have a condition and set it to false. So usually flag is true at the beginning, you start iterating. Inside the loop, you test for the ending condition, like when n is equal with 1, you want to stop. And when the condition is reached, you turn the flag off, so the more flag is equal false, and then it will exit at the next time it checks the more flag. So it's basically very similar to when the condition is right here. But instead of computing that condition and including it here, we include it as an if statement that sets the flag to false, maybe some complex condition here instead of having it here. Maybe sometimes you have multiple conditions, like you compute a sum for the numbers from 1 to 20, but you don't want to include 1, you don't want to include 10, you don't want to include 11, and so on. You would have an if statement for each of them, like if n is 1, skip it. If n is, or stop. If n is 10, stop, and so on. So if you want to compute the sum for the numbers from 1 to 4, here is how you would run it. And this is also good for you to see how do you actually trace a program. So I give you this code, integer sum is equal to 0. For every integer I from 1, as long as I is less than 4, I is incremented with 1 after each iteration, the sum is incremented with I. So usually you start by writing the two variables down, sum and I. And initially the sum is 0 and I is 1. So now you start executing the program. 1 is less than 4, less than equal with 4 is true. So the sum is equal with the old sum, which was 0, plus the value of I, which is 1, which is equal with 1. So the sum is now 1. So either that you write the values one under another, or you cut the old value. I left them all visible, so it's easy to see that the sum was 0, now I is 1, and this new sum is 1. And then you increment I to 2. That's a new value for I. Then 2 is less than 4 is still true. So the sum is incremented with 2. So the old sum, which was 1, plus 2 is 3. Then I is incremented with 1. 3 less than 4 is true. So the sum, which was 3, is incremented with 3, the value of I, which is 6. And now I is incremented from 3 to 4. 4 less than equal with 4 is still true. So we basically increment the sum with 4. 6 plus 4 is 10. Then I is incremented with 1. 5 less than equal with 4 is false, and we exit the program. And we can see basically that the values of the variables right at the end are 10 for the sum and 5 for I. So really you can trace the program. I always recommend that you use a piece of paper to write down the values and trace the program to see what it does, so you know the values of the variables at the end of the program. nested loops. So let's assume that you want to print a matrix. And in either you want this matrix to be 10 rows by 10 columns. And in each cell, you want the product of the row number I and the column number j. So usually you write for this a nested loop. For every I from which is the row number from 1 up to 10. So I is 1 at the beginning, 1 less than 10 is true. Now we have an internal for which actually prints the columns for every j from 1 to 10, compute the product, which is I multiplied with j, and print out the product followed by a space. And you do this 10 times. So you will basically get the values of the products of row number 1 with columns from 1 to 10. That's how we got here, 1 to 10. You finish the internal for loop, and then you print out new line character before you go and increment I to 2 and repeat the entire thing. 2 less than 10 is true. For every j equal with 1, 1 less than 10 is true, compute the product and so on. So you get the multiples of 2 in the second line, then the multiples of 3 in the second line and so on. So it's very useful to have this kind of nested loops to print matrices. Could you use println? So internally, because you want to print in the same line all of the products for one row, you use print. You can't use println here because it will go to the next line. So instead of having a matrix, you will have just one column with all of the rows concatenated. So the println is really at the end. Actually, your question is much better. Can you use println here? And the answer to that is true, yes, because this is printed outside the row. So after we print a row, we print a new line. So either that you use print new line character or println, that's good. So let's modify the program. Let's say that I want to do something similar, but I want the user to enter how many rows and how many columns. We want to print a square matrix. So input scanner. And we'll basically prompt the user to enter a number. And now we are going to read it, integer n. It's input dot next integer. So now let's say that I want to print that matrix. So for every integer I from row number 1, as long as I is less than equal with n, I plus 1, then we print every row. So we need another for loop that iterates from integer j equal with 1 as long as j is less than equal with n, j plus plus. We print out, let's say, a different value. Maybe we print out I square plus j square, a different formula, concatenated with a space. And after each row, we print a new line. So let's run this program. So I want 4 by 4, and this will print 1 plus 1 square plus 1 square is 2, 1 square plus 2 square, which is 1 plus 4 is 5, 1 square plus 3 square is 1 plus 9 is 10, and then 1 plus 16. 4 square is 17. Then the next row is 4 plus 1 is 5, then 4 plus 4 is 8, and so on. So it prints a matrix. Yes, there is math.power. So I could have written math.pow of I to the power 2. But since this is real, I would have to cast it to an integer. So that's another way to do exactly the same. Do we want brackets for the second loop? No, because we have a single statement within the loop. So the curly braces, like for instance, in if statements are not required if you have a single statement. If you have multiple statements, like for instance, for the outer loop, I have a for and then a system out, then I needed to put the curly braces to make a block. So I omitted the curly braces here because they are not required. Okay. In fact, if you want, I can, I don't need to, I mean, here I need to put them because I have two statements. So that's how you do nested loops. Now, variables declared in if statement, in for statements, are local inside that block. So remember one thing, we talked about local variables. Basically, we had this example in one of the previous lectures in which you define some variable j is equal with zero inside an inner block. But then you have a system.out.print the value of j, and it tells us that j doesn't exist. You want to create the variable j. The variable j is only available between where it was declared up to the end of the block in which it was declared. So why is this important to loops? It's important to loops because the variables defined within loops are local to that context. So for instance, let's say that I have a loop for every I from zero, I is less than four, I plus plus, and maybe I have here some statements, integer j is equal with I square, okay? I need to put an integer here too. Now, the problem here is that the variable, the local variable is created, but the outer variable, it doesn't exist. It's like basically this would be a block by itself in which I'm defining a variable j and I'm using it. But now I have an outer variable that is already, so the inner variable is collected. Moreover, the variable I, which was in the initial condition, is also not available outside the for loop. So for for loops, basically the variables included in the init field do not exist outside the for loop. So they are considered to be local variables to that block. They are available while you are executing the block inside the for loop, but the moment that you finish the for loop, those local variables disappear because they only were defined for inside the for loop, nowhere else. So you cannot, if you try to reference it outside the block, you will get a compiler error. This is exactly what we have here, that this variable I is not known anymore. It was really just defined. It's in some way, you can actually translate this for loop into an inner block that defines the variable I. Then we have, this is a while statement that is inside the body. We have I plus plus that is executed inside here. So I plus plus in the next step. And then we have an end of the loop body. So that's why when you have a for loop, the variable that is in that initial action doesn't exist outside the for loop. So that's one thing to be aware of with local variables. Do not declare variables inside loops. So as long as you can, if you define variables inside loops, you are actually creating and destroying those variables every time you iterate, okay? So it's bad programming if you have a while loop, let's say this while loop that we have here, and for some reason you have a variable declared here, like string s is equal with some new string that contains s. Okay? So the problem is that you are creating a new variable every time you iterate. So it's much better programming style if you create a variable outside the loop and then you just use it inside the loop. It's because you are basically declaring and creating and destroying variables inside the loop at every step. So it's a good programming practice. Now, there are two keywords that are important to loops. And one of them is the break keyword. Where did we encounter the break keyword before?
Switch statements.
Excellent. So in switch statements, the break loop breaks the break statement breaks the block. So it basically says, do not continue with the rest of the statements, jump at the end of the statement and continue with the rest of the statements from there on. That's exactly what the break statement does in loops. So if you have a loop, like in this example, what I want to do is to start with the sum equal with zero, the number equal with zero, iterate with the number up to 20. The number is incremented with one at every step. So from zero to one, then at the next iteration is two, and add them to the sum. So it will start one in the sum, then one plus two is three, then three plus three is six. So it's basically a loop that increments the sum with the number from starting with one. But the moment that I reach 100, I want it to exit. Basically, I want it to sum up to when the sum is 100. So how can I implement this? I basically can implement it by using break. So the moment that I reach a number that is bigger than equal with 100, it exits the while statement. So what this break does, finds the enclosing loop body and exits it. Exits it basically says, I'm not gonna check this condition anymore. I'm just going to exit the while loop. So my code here will actually print that at number 14, when I become number becomes 14, the sum becomes 105, which was bigger, is bigger than 100. So basically what's happening is that it increments the sum 1 plus 2, 3 plus 3, then 6 plus 4, 10, and then 10 plus 5, 15, then 15 plus 6. And it goes like this until it's basically the sum becomes 150. So it was 91 plus 14 is 105. And then it basically says, now I break the loop body and continue with the next statements. Similar to the break statement is the continue statement. So the continue statement is kind of like the break statement, but it skips the rest of the loop. It still tries the next iteration. So in this example, I want the same thing, iterate from 1 to 20, increment, add in the sum all the numbers with the exception of 10 and 11. So for 10 and 11, continue will skip the rest of the code in that while statement, but it still goes back to check the while statement. So while the number is less than 20, increment the number. If the number is 10 or 11, skip and continue with number is less than 20 and so on. So really the number that it reaches is still 20, but two numbers were not added to the sum. And those two numbers were 10 and 11. Okay. It's very useful, again, if you want to skip, you have a loop which has a certain number of steps, but there are some exceptions that you want to skip. So that's exactly what the continue keyword does. Okay. So the next topic that I want to talk about today are methods. So remember the main method. So in the main method, basically, we had a single block of code that was executed sequentially. The same thing that the main method does can be done in other methods. So let's start with an opening problem. We want to find the sum of integers from 1 to 10, the sum of integers from 20 to 30, the sum of integers from 35 to 45 and so on. Basically different ranges of natural numbers and the sum of integers in those ranges. So the way that one would start implementing it would to write would be to basically define a variable sum equal to 0, and the loop that iterates from 1 up to 10 included, and adds the values of I to the sum. And after the loop terminates, it prints out that that was the sum between from 1 to 10. But then, because we also want from 20 to 30, we would just write the same code as before. Sum is assigned 0. The for every integer from I equal 20, as long as I is less than 30, increment the sum with I. So again, we reset the sum, and then we put all the numbers from 20 to 30 in the sum, and we printed the result. And again, we do exactly the same thing for 35, 45. But this is bad programming. And the reason why is that we have the same code repeated multiple times. If we made a mistake, let's say that here we had strictly less instead of less than equal, we would have made that mistake 3 times. And in order to correct it, we would have to correct it multiple times. So the solution for that is use a method. Never duplicate code. Write the code once and reuse it. And that's exactly what we are doing here. We wrote a method, static, public static int sum, int i1 and i2. Then we have an inner local variable sum assigned 0. We have a for loop that iterates from i1, I equal i1, as long as I is less than i2. The sum is incremented with I, and we increment I after each iteration. Once we are done with the for loop and we iterated from i1 to i2, we return the sum. So now in the main method, we are not going to write 3 for loops. We are just going to invoke the sum method 3 times. Once for values between 1 and 10, once from values from 20 to 30, or from values from 35 to 45. So really the advantage is that we only wrote the code once, and we invoke it with different parameters. So now the variables that are defined inside the method are called formal parameters. These are basically the parameters that the new names for those variables inside that method. The ones that are used when we call the method, when we invoke the method, are called arguments or actual parameters. Ask me in my office hours that question. So let's continue. So basically, today what we will do, we will basically learn how to write methods in order to shorten our programs, avoiding writing identical code twice or even more times, make fully tested methods that can be trusted. And the only thing that we need to remember is the signature of the method. How is the method invoked and what does it return? We don't need to know how is it implemented internally. So this is how we are using already methods like the character at of a string. We don't know how is it implemented internally, that we know that that method exists in the application programming interface. So we can invoke it and it will give us a character from the string. So it makes the code more readable, because now in the main method, we don't have a lot of for loops. We can just look at the code and know, okay, so we are printing these numbers 3 times. It makes it reusable in other contexts. Maybe we use them again. It makes it more testable. We only have to test the method once. And once we basically trust it, we don't actually need to test it again. It makes it easier to debug. We test the individual methods separately, easier to extend. If we need to modify the functionality of the method a little bit, we can only modify it once, and adaptable to new tasks. Yes, one question in the chat is, do you always have to return a value? This is the return type. You can actually set it as void. And in that case, you don't need to return to have a return statement. Okay. Now, the rule of thumb is that every time you need an operation more than once, make a method for it. Because it's very clear that you will need it more than two times in the future. So make a method for it, and the code is going to be more modular. So how do we define methods and how do we invoke them? A method is a collection of statements that will be executed when we invoke the method. So here we have a new method, public static int max. It takes two formal parameters, number one and number two of the type integer each. And what it basically does internally, it defines a variable result. If the number one is greater than number two, then the result is number one. So number one is the maximum between the two. Else, the result is assigned number two. Number two is the maximum between the two. And we return the result. And here we have an invocation. Let's say that we want to invoke the method max with two variables, x and y. X is, let's say, 5 and y is 2. So this will invoke the method. It will execute internally. It will pass, it will copy the values of these actual parameters of arguments. The value of x, it will be copied in number one, and the value of y, it will be copied in number two. We execute here, we find the maximum between the two, and we return it, and that will be assigned to z. So multiple parts of this method definition. First, we have modifiers. So the modifiers are what is the visibility of this method. Public means that it's visible to all other classes in all packages in Java. And static, that is a method that can be invoked with the name of the class. It doesn't have to be invoked with an object of that class, an instance of that class. Then we have the return type of this method. It's basically the type of what is returned by the method. Inside the method, on all possible execution paths, we must encounter a return statement. The type of the value that is returned is the return type value. So basically this, the type that is returned by the method. The type and the name of the method and its parameters is called the signature of the method. So the signature is basically telling us how do we invoke this method. It's invoked with a name like max and a list of formal parameters. The formal parameters are local variables to the method, which will take a copy of the values of the actual parameters. Yes, if you don't have any parameters here defined, you have open close parentheses, then you invoke that method with no parameters. So yes, you can invoke it without parameters. In the invocation, you have to have the same number of parameters that you have in the signature of the method. When a method is invoked, you actually pass the value of the arguments, so x and y, to the variables num1 and num2. It's kind of like you have assignment. Num1 is equal with the value of x, num2 is equal with the value of y. This kind of calling methods is called call by value, because you are not referencing the same variable, but you are copying the value of the variable in the caller method into this method that you called.
Oh, sorry, Professor, quick question.
Go ahead.
So for the, when you're invoking the method, like the function max is to find the maximum value, right? But then why are you equaling that to z? That, like, that's just one value. Like, how would they compare what's...
So you want to pass it, you want to use it in the main method. So let's say that I have the variable x is equal with 5, y is equal with 2. Now I define the variable z, which is equal with the maximum of x and y. And then I want to print the value of z. So this is an outer variable that is assigned the value of max. Okay. So the max is now public static int max, takes two parameters, let's call them num1 and num2. And here I can even write it in one statement. return. If num1 is greater than num2, then return num1, otherwise return num2. So basically what I do, max is invoked, it returns a value and I'm assigning that value to z. And then I can use z for whatever I want. Maybe I didn't want to print z, I wanted to compute the area of a radius equal with the maximum of between x and y.
Thank you. What's the use of the question mark and the semicolon and the colon?
Ah, so that is something that we covered last class when we talked about selections, is what is called a conditional statement. Instead of writing an if-then statement, we have something called conditional operator. So instead of writing if x is greater than zero, y is equal with one, else y is equal with minus one, we can do a single assignment. We can do it as an expression that is evaluated. If x is greater than zero, then return one, otherwise return minus one. It has this form that we have below, and you can find more details about it in the selections chapter that we covered, I believe, last week.
Got it. Thank you.
Welcome. Okay. So what basically happens when you write a program like this? So this is exactly the same program that we had, only the names of the variables outside are I and j instead of x and y. So basically, I is assigned 5, j is assigned 2, k is defined, and then it calls maximum between I and j. So it passes the values of I and j to num1 and num2. Then it executes internally the max method, result is defined. Is 5 greater than 2, which are the values of num1 and num2? It's yes. So result is assigned num1, and we return the result, which is assigned to k. And then we print out the maximum between I and j is k. So basically, we have a method that calls another method. Okay. So the benefits is that you write a method once and you reuse it anywhere you want. You want it max in some place, you used it. You want it again somewhere else, you just invoke it. You are hiding the implementation for the user. The user only sees the API, the application programming interface. How is this method invoked? Nothing else. Okay. So this API, and let me spell it out. So application programming interface is the set of public methods that is available to a class. Okay. So you really don't know and don't care what is in the method body. Really, that's kind of like a black box to you. You are only interested in what is the list of public methods that I can use from that class. So that's exactly what Java does internally. It basically, the API is how you invoke the class. You don't care about how it is internally implemented. So this is what we use for the string class. If you remember, for string, we just wanted the API. And the API basically gives us the list of all the methods available for string. So we know that the class string has character add, has compare to, has concat, and so on. These are methods available for strings. I don't care how is it implemented internally. Basically, only thing that I care is that how is it invoked? What's the method header, the signature of the method? I will call it with the appropriate parameters, and I'm expecting it to return the values of those parameters, okay, the output for that method. And this, if you want the list of all the public methods that are available for classes that you define, you can use the Java doc that we discussed at the beginning of the semester. We said that for a class, you can basically generate the Java doc for your project, and that will generate an HTML that enumerates all the methods that are available for your class, and then you can use them. So really the API will basically tell you, here are the methods available in this program, everything else is not available. Now, if your method returns a type, different than void. Then a return statement is required for the method on all the possible execution paths. What do I mean by that? Look at this program here, public static integer sign int n. If n is greater than zero, return one. Else if n is equal with zero, return zero. Else if n is less than zero, return minus one. Java will tell you that this method has a compiler error. And the reason why is because Java doesn't execute if statements. It just sees that syntactically, this program may have a case when this condition is false, this condition is false, this condition is false, and we are not returning anything because there is no else for this if. So in Java, on all possible execution paths through a method, you must have a return statement that returns something for a value returning method, a method that doesn't have the return type as void. If you have some type returned, then you must have a return value on all possible execution paths. Okay. Now, how can we fix this method? We know that semantically, if n is not greater than zero and is not zero, it must be less than zero. So basically, the easier way to fix this method is to delete this last if statement, because this is the only other case that is possible. So in now, it doesn't matter if this is false and this is false, there is a return value returned on all possible execution paths. Okay. So really the way that you should look is syntactically the program. So if the program has on one possible execution path, without looking at conditions, a case when it doesn't return anything, then you need to return something. Okay. How are methods executed in Java? They are executed using a stack. So let me explain to you in the same example as before. So we start executing this program. Basically, I is assigned 5, J is assigned 2, and these are assigned on the stack. These are aliases of locations on the stack. K is defined, and then we invoke the method max. What happens is that it saves the program counter a register saying that this is the previous activation record on the stack, and it creates a new frame on the stack with the variables that are available for the max method. So the idea is that you always have access to the variables that are defined in your own method, the current method that is executed. And what happens is, as I said before, Java calls by value. It passes the value of I to number one, and the value of J to number two. So basically number one becomes 5 and number two becomes 2, because those are the two values of I and J above. And now we start executing the inner method, the max method on a separate activation record frame on the stack. So result is defined, number one, 5 is greater than 2. The result is assigned 5 and we return 5. So the result is returned. We copy the value from the result to K because maximum was assigned to K. The moment that we finish the method max, we basically delete that frame on the stack. So this frame, the max method, the moment that it returns a value is deleted. So this is the way that a stack is used to execute methods. Okay? So you always look at the current top of the stack. Top of the stack is the last method that was invoked and you are trying to execute internally in that method. If that method calls another method, you create a new frame, Java creates a new frame, and you start executing in that new frame. Okay. Java calls by value, meaning that when you assign the values to the formal parameters, those arguments that are inside the method itself, you are assigning copies of the original data. The consequence is that if you try to assign new values to those variables that are inside the method, these do not affect the original past variables, okay? Because you are basically you have only one directional copying of data. You copy the values of the actual parameters into the formal parameters and you forgot where you copied them from. So that's what call by value means. So in this case, let's say that you want a method that does a swap. So normally a swap would work. Like basically you can use a temporary variable, assign one of the numbers to the temporary variable, swap the number and assign the value to the other variable, the temporary value to the other variable. So let me show you an example. So here I have a main method. Let's say that I have I and J, and I can swap the values in I and J if I assign to or X to temp, then X is assigned the value of Y, and Y is assigned a value of temp. So now if I print what is X and what is Y, it will print that X is 2 and Y is 5. So this is how I would write a swap in the same method. Basically, I can swap two variables with a temporary variable. Okay. So instead of having 5 and 2, I have 2 and 5. But if I take this and I put it in a method, so swap X with Y, and now I have another method, public static void swap that takes integers, let's call them differently, n1 and n2. And here basically temp is assigned n1, n1 is assigned n2, and n2 is assigned temp. I run the program and I still have X is 5 and Y is 2. That is because I did swap N1 and N2, but that didn't change X and Y. X and Y are still the original values. Only thing that I did, I passed the values of X and Y to N1 and N2. I copied the values. So swapping them inside here didn't swap them outside in the caller method, in the main method. And I can actually show you that internally here, N1 and N2 are swapped. N1, this is N2. They are swapped here. So it is the case that N1 is 2 and N2 is 5. But outside, still X and Y are 5 and 2. So the swap did not work. So basically, you're only copying, you see, you're only copying the values from number one and number two outside to N1 and N2. Okay. Now, overloading, sometimes it's possible that you have methods with the same name, but they take different type of parameters, okay? So again, let me show you what overloading is. So public static void max takes integer I and integer j. And let's say that it returns the maximum between I and j. So return if I is greater than j, then return I, otherwise return j. Okay. And it's not void, is an integer, returns an integer. Now I can have a different method max, but with the same name, but instead of taking integers, it takes doubles. And it returns the double maximum between the two. So if I invoke this method with two integers, it calls the first method. So the maximum between 1 and 2, or the maximum between 1.0 and 2. So in the first case, this max will invoke the maximum that takes two integers. In the second case, because one of the operands is a double, it invokes the max that takes the two as doubles. So 2 is raised as a double, and when it returns back, it's 2.0. So we can actually see the difference. So this is called overloading. Overloading is that sometimes you have two or more possible matches, and the compiler basically tries to find the most the best match method for the call that you had, for the invocation that you had. However, sometimes you may have equally matched methods. So for instance, if I have max that takes an int and a double, and max that takes a double and an int, if you call it with two integers, these two are matching equally. So the first one will have to convert 2 to a double. The second one will have to convert 1 to a double. So you will get a syntax error in this line, line number 3 in the program, telling you that I don't know which one to call because they are equally expressive. You basically, they have an equal match to both methods. So this is called an ambiguous invocation. There is no problem in the fact that there are two methods. That's fine. But when you invoke it, it doesn't know which one to invoke. So the error will be in line number 3 because there are basically two methods and both of them fit equally well the invocation. Local variables defined inside methods basically only have the execution within that method. You can't use them outside. So basically, I can't use INJ here because once I return, INJ do not exist anymore. Similarly, if you have a variable that is defined inside a method, you can't define a variable in an inner block of that method. You will get an error. Inside the method, you can have a variable defined only once. Now, the last thing that I want to tell you in 1 minute is the fact that when you have a problem, you want to solve it with basically a step of a method. You try to divide the problem into smaller parts and implement those as separate methods. This strategy is called divide and conquer. And usually you have two opportunities. You can start from the top and, okay, I want to print the calendar. First, I want to read the input, like what month, in what year, and then to print the month. And then printing the month will print the month title and the body. And then to print the body, you will have to get the start date, the number of days in the month, and print it. And you have two options. Top-down approach, which basically says start implementing the methods from the top to the bottom, and bottom-up approach, start implementing the methods from the bottom to the top. And usually they are interleaved. So basically you would try to define the methods and then to see how you would implement each. That's all that I want to talk about today, and we'll continue next class with arrays, and then we'll actually see how to implement various methods like rotate right, rotate left, sorting, binary search, linear search, and so on. So that's all for today. Don't forget to try to run your sample exam with the Logdown browser. Thank you very much, everyone.
Professor?
Yes.